Hi, my name's Jason Kingsley. I'm the CEO and creative director of Rebellion, which is one of the biggest independent games developers in Europe. Bizarrely enough, I have a zoology degree from Oxford University, and I don't really know why I did that. I was just sort of on the flow, really, of doing education. I enjoyed biology, I enjoyed what I was studying, and zoology made sense at the time. It hasn't directly translated into a job for me, but what is interesting is it's taught me the basics of analysis and thought processes and how to actually encompass a subject well, how to present. And it was good fun at the time, and I made some good friends on the course, so I thoroughly recommend it, but it hasn't got me a job in computer games. Well, very weirdly, I was always playing computer games, and I was always coding them with my brother, or rather, I designed them, my brother coded them. We did role-playing games and all sorts of weird things like that when we were kids. So the passion, which was to make games and to entertain people, was really what I wanted to do with my whole life. But education was a kind of, if you like, not a treadmill as such, but a conveyor belt which took me through to a degree, and I really enjoyed it. But at the same time, in parallel, I built up skills in designing and communicating and writing and presentation, which then led to me and my brother starting our own company. Being an indie, probably one of the biggest indies, and we always have arguments about whether we are a true indie or not, and whether we're too big to be an indie, or too successful, and we're going too long or whatever, but we are fully independent. Me and my brother own the company. We don't have any external investors. We don't have any VCs behind us. We reinvest our profits. I guess the advantages are, if we make mistakes, we don't have to tell anybody about it. It's just us. And by and large, in business, you will make mistakes. It's just how many mistakes you make. As long as you make more correct decisions than mistakes, that's a good thing. The benefits of being an indie are that you really can, if you like, you can find your own route through the world. You can decide you want to get into iOS games. You can decide, actually, no, we're not interested in iOS. We want to stick to PC titles, whatever it might be. We've also always developed our games with our own technology. So we've always wanted to maintain the kind of technological grip. We've always thought it's potentially a bit dangerous to work with middleware only. We do work with middleware, but we also maintain our own engine. The idea being there that if a middleware company gets bought, and let's face it, they do get bought for a lot of money sometimes, and when they get bought, things change and you might not be able to use their technology again. So we've always liked the idea of being independent in terms of philosophy and independent in terms of practicality as well. I'm probably one of the worst people in the world to give advice, because I wouldn't have taken my own advice if I'd given it to me at the time. I think what you've got to do really in business is you've got to be completely passionate about what you do. You've got to really enjoy it. You've also got to work hard, and that's a very important part. You tend to make your own luck, and sometimes you've got to be in the right place at the right time. But if you're not in the right places, you can't be there at the right time. And that kind of thing comes through passion and application. And being qualified is one thing that's important, but not the only thing that's important. Sometimes meeting the right people, going to the right conventions, listening, reading, and learning is a very, very important part of it. I mean, there's a whole new wave of independent games companies starting up, which is very, very exciting. And as chair of Tiger, I obviously represent an industry body, if you like, that is trying to encourage that. We're a very big organization with a lot of people. We take people in who've got no experience and train them up in various different areas. But at the same time, we understand that there is sometimes a benefit to having lots of smaller companies out there and a business ecosystem, if you like, that that creates new ideas. And that's good. I mean, we are a big company. We hope to try and be nimble, but we do have our own speed of working sometimes. I think one of the key things in the industry is it is like an ecosystem. You need your big companies like ourselves, big and successful. You need your massive companies like EA, or Activision, which also brings something else there. But you also need your grassroots. You need your growth. You need the kind of bottom layer. Here's my zoology coming out. You need your bottom layer of small plants that are on the forest floor. And if a big tree falls over, and they do, let's face it, big companies come and go sometimes, but the little ones can take advantage of that and then grow where the once was shade. They can then grow into the light. And also, it can expand, and forests expand by growing from the edges outwards. They don't grow from the middle, they grow outwards that way. And so the edges are often new environments, and then things that are new grow in those places. So you see, the zoology was important. The whole biology and evolution thing has come out. There you go. One of the interesting things as having a bigger company is I've got somebody who does HR for me. So if you like, I've got a gatekeeper who will take the paperwork that comes through. And don't forget, that's the only way somebody knows you to begin with in the industry. When you're applying somewhere, your one shop window, if you like, is that piece of paper that you present, is that electronic document, is that the spreadsheet or the samples you send in or whatever it might be, or the portfolio. That is crucially important. If that's rubbish, and be really honest with yourself, if it's rubbish, you won't get past the first gatekeeper. Once the first gatekeeper has looked through stuff, I or other colleagues of mine will get, if you like, a long list of people, and then we'll go through those and we'll analyze a little bit of what it says in the CV. So having a degree is part of it. Having a passion, you know, having hobbies that say I play computer games a lot is really useful if you want to get into computer games. I actually once got a CV from somebody who had all the qualifications. They had a computer science degree, which was great, from a good university. I thought I'd interview them anyway. I interviewed them. They didn't play computer games. Now, why would I, as a computer games company, want somebody that worked for me to make computer games who really didn't care whether they played computer games or not? And I just thought it was silly. It was a waste of that person's time and a waste of my time as well. So having a passion for computer games, being able to talk coherently about them, being able to analyze them as well and go, I really liked game A because it did all these interesting things, but I didn't like it in parts because of this bit and this bit and this bit. So having a critical eye as opposed to a fanboy eye is quite important as a professional. And also being able to discuss it as well, particularly if you want to get into design or production. Coding is the same, but you'll see it from a different perspective, and obviously you have to pass certain coding tests and do certain tests. It's really hard to judge. The easiest type of person to judge is an artist, because they have a portfolio. So you can see, most people can tell whether it's good, medium, bad, with potential, shows promise, whatever it might be. Coding, obviously, you can code right or wrong. That's an easy thing to do, and you can certainly have a discussion about it. Design and production are much harder to judge in a kind of black and white way. Hard to judge whether somebody's going to be a good producer or not, but that comes down to personality. So different kind of things you need for each of the jobs in the games industry. I think what's interesting in games in particular is the fact that the film industry and the television industry and the games industry all create visual things on screen, and there are many, many more crossover skills. So we get people from the film industry who've been working on major movies come to us and they want to work on major games, and that's fine, and their skills are almost completely transferable. I haven't really noticed any competition with the BBC as such in terms of them hiring people, but we have hired people from the BBC. So we have a very small turnover at Rebellion, I think partly because we've got a big company and we work on some big games. But then again, you know, people do move on from time to time. They want to try different things out, and they go with my blessings usually. So the skill set is very similar, increasingly more similar than it used to be. In the old days of the 8-bit computers, you couldn't really show much on screen, and it was a bit more arguably a bit more techy and a bit less arty. But now what we're producing in demos is very, very similar in quality to what might be linear animation or these other sort of areas of television animation. They're not that dissimilar anymore. And obviously the top end movie resolutions and top end movie animations are just awesomely great. But we're not that far behind in the computer games industry, and we catch up with people very, very quickly. Great. The thing is that computer games will always need to be played. People want to play computer games. I love watching movies, I like reading books, I like playing computer games. It's just another form of media. So I don't see any drop-off in the number of people who are actually wanting to play computer games or needing to. What I see is a change in the way that we talk to the consumer, the gamers. Gamers can have a one-to-one relationship with us in some ways. We can deliver a game direct to the consumer. They, if they want to, can tell us who they are, what they like and what they dislike, and we can perhaps modify the game in response to that. I mean, we're looking at one of our titles, Sniper Elite, the new Sniper Elite that's coming out sometime early 2012. It's very exciting for us because we're doing digital distribution directly. So we will be supporting that game over time So people that buy the game will get new stuff, and we'll be able to give feedback to the fans, and the fans will be able to give us feedback and say, yeah, we liked it. You know, it's an 8.5 out of 10 game, but if you made it this and this and this, it'll be an 8.7 or a 9 out of 10. And that's very exciting from a creative point of view. We as games designers think we know, to the best of our abilities, what will make an entertaining game. Ultimately, the acid test is what the consumer thinks en masse. So you will never please all the people all of the time, and you will always change something, and then there will always be somebody who sends a harshly worded email to you saying that you're an idiot and a fool. And generally speaking, we're not idiots and fools, but we make decisions sometimes that a lot of people like and some people don't like. But you know, you do your best. You know, you put your head above the parapet and somebody's going to fire arrows at it.